felt the same way. I was sitting there saying, I'm listening to the Andrews sisters. My gosh, that brings back great memories for me.
Greetings from the Andrews sisters. I'm Patty.
I'm Maxine.
And I'm Laverne.
We're making these V-discs just for you.
Entertainers also recorded for the Armed Forces Radio Service, and the record companies supported the war effort too by creating victory discs, or V-discs, specifically for the troops overseas. One of the most popular records was the Andrews Sisters' Rum and Coca-Cola.
Drinking rum and Coca-Cola.
They had that kind of Latin beat to their music sometimes. They had wonderful rhythm. People were dying to listen to it and buy it. And you'd be driving in the car and you'd go down the street and you'd hear the music.
Young girls say they treat them nice, make Trinidad like paradise, drinking rum.
That song has got the most pulled around lines.
Yeah, the more drunk you sound, the better, actually.
It's really, really relaxed and it's very kind of easy on the ear and kind of lilting song, and you can really have a lot of fun with the phrasing, really pull the time around as if you're kind of going to fall over it.
That's what we do.
That's what we
do. I think that they did it a bit more in time.
But they did it more in time, but they had funny kind of accents, didn't they? They had kind of a bit.
Oh, yeah, they did the Trinidad.
When she heard a bingo.
Now bingo cool. It's genius.
Drinking rum and Coca-Cola.
The song became so popular and controversial, you know. Both mother and daughter working for the Yankee dollar.
Rum and Coca-Cola earned another gold disc for the girls, and the war years proved to be a prolific recording period for the sisters.
In the 1940s, you could say, well, it's all kind of dreamy and it sounds uninvolved. It's because life was tough enough. You needed a relief from that. You needed comfort, you know. People talk about comfort food. This is comfort music.
Shambles, all I've treasured has gone.
It starts to become sentimental. It starts to become emotional. You know, things are serious now. You know, people can die.
The sisters were desperate to sing to the troops on the front line, and in 1944, the USO finally arranged for them to travel to Italy.
They appeared literally on the battlefront, on makeshift stages, with thousands of GIs in the audience, exhausted, covered in dirt and dust, but cheering them on the way because they were something from home.
They were performing in the wild. Many times they weren't performing with a band at all. They were performing with an accordion, a guitar, whatever was around.
Walking down Lover's Lane with anyone else but me.
They put them in a barracks, and the boys would all come to them like before a show and give them shavings of their soap in one helmet and warm water in another so that they could freshen up.
Yeah, if you think about it, it was great PR for them. The troops would write home to their girlfriends or their mothers and say, I saw the Andrews sisters. They were terrific. And they were.
Most servicemen get a crush on one person, Betty Grable, Rita Hayworth, whoever it happened to be, but in this situation, they got a crush on three.
Here they are in person, the Andrews sisters.
I remember Maxine talking about going over to the USO tour. They said, they don't want you to come on sexy. What they want from you is they want something that reminds them of home in a wholesome, warm, female, feminine way.
And the boys would just go nuts. They'd hop over one another to get as close as they could to the girls.
It's gonna be a hallelujah day.
And the more lively their songs were, the more they danced around the stage, the crazier the fellas got. The Andrews sisters had a way, under the worst conditions, to make the fellas just forget their troubles at that time.
I think we needed pinup girls like Betty Grable, and I think we needed girls like the Andrews sisters who were like their sisters, literally. So they were more than each other's sisters. I think they were sisters to the entire nation.
Oh, lay that pistol down, babe, lay that pistol down.
The end of the war in 1945 sparked a nationwide celebration in America. The Andrews Sisters' entertainment of the troops confirmed them as one of the country's favourite acts. Life began to return to normal, and the Andrews family settled in Hollywood. The parents' vice-like grip on their daughters' lives began to loosen, and in the years following the war, both Laverne and Patty married, while Maxine and husband Lou were keen to start a family.
They had an apartment in New York and a home in the Hollywood Hills, and they adopted a little girl, Alida Ann Levy, and then they adopted in, I think, 46, Peter. Neither she nor Patty nor Laverne had been able to conceive. I think she really was a good mother. She really was. She provided the kids with everything. So it was a great life at that point. Later in her life, I don't think she had as good a relationship with her children as she would have liked to have had. And I think a lot of it has to do with a lot of the Hollywood stories that you hear, which is mom was never there, you know? And as much as she wanted to be there, there was that career.
Is you is, or is you ain't my baby.
Their chart-topping success with Bing Crosby back in 1939 paved the way for a series of hit collaborations. Their versions of songs such as Don't Fence Me In and Accentuate the Positive became instant classics. The girls' contribution to these recordings cannot be underestimated. They chose the music, while Vic Schoen, their musical director, came up with the arrangements.
If you listen to the way that Crosby would fit himself into their arrangements too, that just shows how much he trusted their musicianship. And a lot of that stuff was improv. A lot of that was just on the spot. Crosby said, hey, I'll try this or that, and the girls would rearrange what they did. So, yeah, and it must have been a hell of a lot of fun in the studio.
It was a very happy time in America when they made some records together and sang. They were warm and dear and charming and funny. It was always a thrill.
After making 13 movies in just 5 years, the girls' contract with Universal ended in 1945. They were then free to star in movies with any Hollywood studio they liked. In 1947, they signed up with Bob Hope and Bing Crosby to appear in Paramount's Road to Rio.
They only did the one song in the movie. But they were spotlighted well, they were dressed well, they were coiffed and made up well, they looked good.
What more would you want anyone to say?
They worked wonderfully with Crosby, they sounded great. I think their best musical moment on film ever.
You don't have to mention that Yankee phrase, aye, aye.
Perhaps when you end your vacation, you bring back a bit of the zing, so you can understand what she's saying. You need an interpreter still, but you don't even have to know the language.
With the moon in the sky and the girl in your arms and a look in her eyes.
Aye, 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 aye. No, you don't have to know the language if you don't want to say goodbye.
In the immediate post-war years, the Andrews Sisters continued to have hit records, but the end of the decade would signal a change in their fortunes. Both parents died, and Patty and Maxine were devastated by the collapse of their marriages. A further blow came with the early death of their greatest supporter, president of Decca Records, Jack Capp. And with rock and roll just around the corner, the girls found themselves going out of fashion fast.
Decca executives decided, well, the Andrews Sisters aren't selling. Let's see what maybe Patty can do. So increasingly, they had recordings where Patty dominated the recording, and this is illustrated by I Can Dream, Can't I? That's virtually Patty's song, her record. At the very end, Maxine and Laverne come in.
Can I pretend that I'm locked in the bend of your embrace?
Patty was a fireball. She was a comedian. She was funny. She had terrific energy. She was the star of the group.
She was a huge talent. Laverne had a beautiful voice. but wasn't really good looking. Maxine had no desire to sing solo. In her mind, the trio was everything, but Patty was the center of focus.
The Andrews sisters were still under contract as the Andrews sisters. So even though Patty may be doing solos, those royalties were divided three ways, and Maxine and Laverne got a couple of, a third of them each, even though they were not on the recording. So that probably didn't settle too well with Patty.
The sisters began looking for someone to blame for their declining record sales. They fired their long-term musical director, Vic Schoen, the man many attributed to their success. But it didn't change a thing, and the rift between the sisters continued to widen.
It's like with any group or band, you get on each other's nerves. Each one was thinking a little bit differently now, not as a unit any longer.
The girls replaced Vic Schoen as musical director with Patty's new boyfriend, Wally Weschler. It wasn't long before Wally ousted Lou Levy as the sisters' manager too, becoming the group's domineering leader. Soon, he was pushing for Patty to go solo.
This is the old story. It's like the Supremes and Diana Ross, There's a tendency in the business to focus on the lead singer, the individual. Can we get rid of the other people, these extraneous people? Can we focus on the one individual?
And you become the center of attraction long enough, you begin to really want to take that on yourself. So she wanted to go. She wanted to fly.
Patty denies this. If she were here right now at the age of 90 and able to speak to you, she would deny it. She denied it to me. She said, I never wanted to go solo.
Patty finally left the group to pursue her solo career at the end of 1953. She signed a contract with Capitol Records, but only had limited chart success.
When Patty made her first solo appearance, Laverne crept into the back of the room just as Patty went on and sat there and watched her sister as a solo performer with tears rolling down her cheeks, feeling that the other sisters weren't with her. When stars
appear. It didn't work for any of them. Laverne and Maxine, their income virtually disappeared after the trio broke up. When the sisters appeared at Vegas, they made something like $15,000 a week. And when Patty was there, she made $1,500. So we're talking about really significantly reduced salaries.
Love, love, hooray for love. After just 2 years, in 1956, the girls reformed at a highly publicized Bury the Hatchet press launch. They immediately signed a new recording deal with Capitol Records.
Their first album at Capitol actually was a greatest hits, and of course that was a big sensation. And then Capitol experimented and they came out with this album called Fresh and Fancy Free. And I think it's one of the most spectacular things that they did. It wasn't very popular, and Capitol just didn't know what to do with them, which is very strange to me, because the magic is still there.
At this point, they're becoming an oldies act.